summer to the Sunrise Safari. This is Safari Live, and it is bitterly cold. And we're not the only ones who think so. There's a little side-striped jackal curled into the tightest little ball to try to keep warm. It's about 11 degrees Celsius, 51 Fahrenheit, and for us low-fault dwellers, it's pretty chilly. So, what an exciting morning. There's not a cloud in the sky. I think we're going to have a spectacular sunrise. And lots of exciting prospects for us to see today. And my name is Brent Smith. I have VM, aka the Wildebeest Dawnbrunk, on camera. On the other vehicle, we have Jamie and Jandre. And last night, Sunset Safari, we had Karula on a kill. After we left, her cubs came, but it was a bit too close to sunset to go back. So what I'm doing now is waiting for the sun to rise. And once it's a bit lighter, we're going to go see if she managed to keep that kill through the night. And if we can go see those wonderful little bundles of joy. So very exciting. And till then, we're going to meander around the sort of northwestern part of Juma, seeing what we can find. And we've already found a side-striped jackal. And we'll come check on him on our way back to Karula. Now, we don't often see jackal, except for the last couple of days we've been seeing jackal every drive, and not only side-striped, we've seen black-backed as well. And Jamie and VM yesterday actually had side-striped chasing a black-backed. So exciting times on the jackal front. We really hope they move back a little bit more permanently, and I'm really hoping the black-backs move back, because their call is one of my favorite calls in the African bush. Wow, wow. Obviously, my impression, that leaves a lot to be desired. And it is going to be a stunning morning. And fingers crossed that there's going to be lots of stuff out here to see. Now, this week has been filled with a little critters we don't see too much, like the jackal. And this week, I think I've seen, unfortunately not all of them while we were live, but I've seen civet, honey badger, and then of course, the pangolin, which was a first for a Safari Live. So now the challenge is on to find those few remaining critters that have never been seen. And I think top of the list for most of the presenters is the elusive aardvark. Now, aardvark basically translated means earth pig. And that's what they are. They're sort of pig-like. They're actually quite big animals. A male aardvark can weigh over 60 kilograms. And they eat termites and ants, but they are mostly nocturnal, generally only up and about from about, in this area, from about 10-ish in the evening till about 3-4 in the morning. Now, Vim's only aardvark he's seen here at Safari Live was in a tree, wasn't it, Vim?
Below a tree.
Below a tree, yes. So there was a spate during last year's winter months when Tingana, our dominant male leopard, decided he only ate aardvark. And he ate quite a few in a very short time. And the only aardvark we happened to ever see were being eaten by a leopard. So let's hopefully try find a live one. So while we continue to check this northwestern corner, let's jump back on board with Jamie so she can bid you a good morning.
Good morning and welcome to our portion of the Sunrise Safari. And it's cold enough now that we can actually breathe mist whenever we breathe out. And of course, with that update about the lions, we find, Jandre and myself, find ourselves heading straight towards essentially the coldest place we possibly can on this reserve, which is into the Mwati drainage line. So thank you to all of you who sent through those updates about the lions walking around the Juma Dam pan last night. Not sure whether they were lions or lionesses. You can imagine if you're a guest at the lodge, you don't want a vehicle with bright blazing lights driving right outside your room first thing in the morning while you're trying to have your coffee before heading out. So that means that we can't go and investigate the dam right now before the other guests head out on their safaris. So we're just doing a loop around the area to see if we can't follow up on them. But yes, good morning. My name is Jamie. And this morning I have Jean-André on camera with me as we head down into the coldest place we possibly can. When I was a child of the frosty Highveld. I was born in Johannesburg. I feel like I should have be slightly tougher when it comes to the cold. But then of course I wasn't traveling in an open vehicle, and right now it feels like my fingers want to drop off. But I can only imagine what poor Jean-André is feeling, because he actually has to use them for something more complex than just turning a steering wheel and changing gears every now and again. He's got to do the fiddly focus things. See, I'm really getting my cameraman terminology right. What we're doing at the moment is heading along Twin Dams Road, a road that runs north-south straight through the center of Juma and parallel to its main river system, which is the Mulwati drainage line. I can tell you that the lions, from what I can see from the tracks on the road, they haven't come in this direction. And I suspect that if they were moving around last night, they are going to be very fond of using the roads of this area. The reason I say that is because it is exceptionally dewy this morning. Lions, like all cats, lions are happy enough to swim and get wet if they're chasing something around a dam or crossing a river, but they'd really rather prefer not to walk through long damp grass. I think that they're going to be wanting to use the roads as much as possible. Apparently you've just got an update through that it was 3 lionesses and 1 male. Could it be the Inkahumas and Junior? I would say that is relatively certain. But where have they gone? I know that you are all as keen as I am to see Junior one last time before it really is time for him to move off. He is endangering his own life as well as the lives of the rest of the pride. He's made a very, I suppose we can't call him foolish, but he has made a very unfortunate decision to reassociate himself with the Nkuhuma pride. It is the fastest way to draw attention to himself, especially now that he is a year older and wiser than when the Birmingham boys first came through. When the Birmingham boys are now the dominant male lion coalition in this area. When the Birmingham boys first came through and disrupted the lives of the various lion prides, including the Nkuhumas, Junior was still relatively young. Junior is a young male lion from the Nkuhuma pride. He was still young enough that he seemed to be tolerated by them. There was even one sighting where he lay down about 100 meters away from the Birmingham males and just behaved submissively. He could get away with that a year ago. He is now a fully fledged adult. He's been moving about on his own, right into Kruger, down to Mala Mala. And I don't think he's going to be met with the same level of tolerance that he was last year. We've got to keep our fingers crossed that he realizes this and actually moves off. Oh my goodness, sorry Jean-André. Oh, this is the coldest patch. You know how when we stop the car and we look out over the misty morning and there's always that nice big patch of mist? That's the Mulwati drainage line, and that's where we are right now. I've got my hot water bottle. I can keep swapping hands so I can keep my fingers warm. And the worst thing about this, of course, is that this is not even proper winter yet. This is still us having it easy at the low 50s Fahrenheit. Tim, you were wondering what the lowest temperature it ever gets here is. The lowest it usually gets, and it's at this time of the morning, is around 0 degrees centigrade, so 32 Fahrenheit. That's just the sort of normal temperature. As soon as you factor in the wind chill from driving in an open vehicle, and it's a serious wind chill factor, you probably drop several degrees below zero, so into the high 20s Fahrenheit. Now this is nothing really. This is just us having to reacclimatize. It's actually beautiful weather. I mean, apart from this crisp freezing cold, the climate at the temperature at the moment is really very pleasant. The days are not too hot, they're not too cold. And just thoroughly enjoyable. All right. These lions have not come south. It's now time to check to the east. I suspect they're going to be moving around north and east. That is what I would be doing if I were them. Trying to stay away from the Birmingham boys, although we don't know where all of the Birmingham boys are. Oh, okay. Now we really have hit the coldest patch. And a very good morning to Anya, who is a new viewer, one of our newest viewers. And Anya, you are not wrong in the slightest. You are absolutely right. This is taking place in South Africa. We are coming to you live. So what that means is that what you're seeing is happening right here in the middle of a place called Juma Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves, which are all part of the Sabi Sands Game Reserve, which has a reputation for some of the most extraordinary animal viewing in the world. And all of that is part of the Greater Kruger National Park area. So you're looking at 4 million hectares of wild area that the animals can wander about in unfenced. One of the largest, a bit light now for the spotlight, one of the largest conservation areas in Africa and one of the best protected. That is where we are, right up in that northeastern corner of South Africa, and we come to you live twice a day every day, so I'm very chuffed to hear that you have stumbled across our live stream. I'm going to focus on finding you those lions for this morning. Let's find out what Brent is up to.
So it's a little bit lighter. We've gone and done a loop past Sydney's waterhole. Not much happening there. But there's our little jackal friend. And it almost looks like it's a log out there on the sort of middle right of screen. And fast asleep, curled in a lovely little tight ball, trying to keep warm. And you can see how that jackal's camouflage works. Now, I think even a leopard walking down the road wouldn't spot that little jackal curled up in a ball. Speaking of leopards, the light is here. So we're gonna go see what happened overnight at Karula's impala kill. And very exciting, hopefully the cubs are there. Hopefully the hyenas haven't managed to smell it out overnight and steal it. So far so good, we're on impala road. And then no hyena tracks yet. Now, the one negative for Karula about where that kill is and where it was on the ground is the hyenas definitely do like to walk down Impala Road. So we're hoping that they were busy dealing with that remains of that buffalo carcass they stole from the Inca Umas and didn't meander too far last night. So we are bundled up against the cold, and we even have hot water bottles this morning. And I found an extra one, so the cameraman that gets to drive with me gets an extra perk. So when I'm making hot water bottles for Jamie and myself, I make a third. And it does just make this early morning that much more pleasant. Now, Jamie said she's ordered electric ones. from Kirsten, because Kirsten's coming back from leave soon, and I've never heard of an electric hot water bottle, but I'm quite excited to try it. I don't know if I'm going to let go of my traditional one, though, that sits on my lap. Maybe I can have two. Oh, elephant's been putting sticks in the road again. A very good morning to Sandy in Toronto. Now, Toronto knows a lot more about being cold than we do out here. Bitterly cold in the winter months in Toronto. Now, Sandy's wondering, which do I find more prolific, the sunrise or sunset safaris? Well, it all depends. Quite often, you use your sunrise safari to set up your sunset safari, specifically when it comes to the cats. So I really love the early mornings because there's a chance at fresh tracks, there's lots to follow, where the sunset can be a bit quieter. And normally you've done the tracking in the morning, or someone has, and you've got animals for the evening. Of course, that doesn't always work, but in theory. But I think for me, at the moment, I'm really enjoying the sunrise safaris. What I enjoy, I would even enjoy a midday safari. I love being out in the bush. Okay, so I'm looking at the road carefully. Vim, there are no hyena tracks yet. Vim was convinced that maybe the kill had been stolen, but so far, so good. It's not often that I hope VM's wrong, but this morning is one of those mornings. So the kill's just through here, or was just through there, is hopefully. Turn off my lights. Don't need them anymore. So I've engaged the vehicle into low range, so that means it's in four-wheel drive, so the revs are very low. Okay, so was underneath that weeping wattle over there. Let's check carefully around. And of course, we gotta look in the tree. She might have moved it and hoisted it. I think the most likely tree to have been hoisted was off to the left there. Just yet. Just really hoping she managed to put it in a tree. I'm not seeing any sign of the carcass. See any drag marks coming out. Oh, silly little tree. There we go. I think the most likely place for her to hoist would have been off to there. This is where the kill was. Was just in there. You can see there's a few fluffs of hair and some blood on the ground. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to Jamie while I have a better look around this area to see if we can find Queen Karula. Hopefully she has managed to pop it in a tree.
Fingers crossed that that kill is still around and hasn't been nicked by the hyenas. And speaking of hyenas, Jandre spotted something bizarre, kind of a bit like making up what you see in the shape of the clouds. We've got what looks like a silhouette of a hyena in a marula tree. It's obviously not. Just have a look there on the left-hand fork. It looks like a hyena standing in the middle of the tree. Although, Jandre, now that we've said that, it actually really doesn't. It did earlier. The light's just gone not quite right. Now it really does just look like a branch and like we've lost our minds, which we quite possibly have. Found the tracks of the lions straight east, which is kind of what I was hoping it would. They wouldn't be going, or in the direction that they wouldn't be going. That's why I was sort of checking south first in the hope that they were going that way. That's the direction of Torchwood, which is the property of our eastern boundary, to the east of our boundary, and that is where the Nkuhuma female is denning her cubs. Now, so far, I've only seen tracks of females. I'm really hoping that that is the case. I can't show you them just yet. The light's not quite right. It'll be a very, very tricky to show you them, and I want to just keep moving in case they're somewhere close before it gets to the point that they cross our boundary. If you are a newer viewer, or indeed a viewer that's been watching for years, please don't forget to send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And let us know. It doesn't necessarily just have to be questions. You can send us through your comments or your thoughts and opinions on what it is you are seeing. I'm just trying to age these tracks. They look beautifully fresh. Must have been from some time. I'm not sure what time the lions were on the damn camera, but these tracks look crispy fresh to me. I'll try and show you. At least we know that we were right in terms of the theory about them walking on the roads. And always using central as a highway. Still the light's not quite right for me to show you. Let's try a little bit further down. And a very good morning to Papa Young, who's watching in Oklahoma. You want to know why I say that it is a bad idea for Junior to have come around. And the answer is for a couple of reasons. The Birmingham boys, the Nkumas, have just had cubs. At least one of them has. The other is pregnant, which is automatically going to make the Birmingham boys more protective over them now. They're invested in the future of the cubs that they believe are theirs and are most likely theirs. They're going to be far more intolerant of the presence of a male. And then there's the fact that his natural instinct could well be to kill the Nkuhuma cubs, which is obviously not something that we want. And you? What's the matter? What's that all about? Little one, so early in the morning for this. Young elephant giving us a little bit of an intimidation dance and then pretending that it just was coming over here for that food anyway, since we haven't shown any sign of being intimidated. I was trying to age the tracks earlier and I noticed some elephant tracks over them. And I was thinking maybe that it might have been older than we thought they were. However, here's our elephants. Now that may well not be the case. Ooh. That didn't look like the most comfortable food choice there. Trying to get to the softer grasses and sedges on the river system's wall. Oh, and there's a little bit of some acacia there as well. young elephants, even of this age, never quite have the coordination of the adults. Like he's kneeling on one, kneeling down on his left knee, on his left knee, ankle actually, if I'm honest. Their knees are actually much further up their legs than we realize. And look at those beautiful eyelashes. Hello, boy. Sorry. Hello, girl. Young girl. They can be a little bit tricky to tell the difference between a male and a female at this age. They don't have the adult profile, so the adult head shape. And since elephants' testicles are internal, can be surprisingly tricky, more so than you might expect. But this is a young cow. I would, if I had to guess at an age for her, probably somewhere in the region of 7, 8, roughly. And in the middle of all of this, the lion tracks that I want to try and show you. Now that she's moved off and up onto the wall a little bit, means that we can go forward and get a little bit of a better view. The rest of the herd I can hear feeding off to the left of me. We should have a view of them as we come through this drainage line. Hello, elephant. I'm sure you know where the lions are. They must have come through here not too long ago. Right, girl. It's okay, girl. It's all right. It's okay, big girl. Our young bulls give you that display all of the time, young females less so. So she is just telling us that she doesn't want us to come any closer. I'm not sure whether that looks like the most appetizing breakfast to me. You can see all of those thorns there. What are you calling it? Where are my binoculars? So she's feeding on a sickle bush, which has these incredibly modified branches to actually form sharp spines that are an attempt by the tree to discourage such feeding activities, but do nothing to put off an elephant. Oh, excuse me. It's the morning dust. The go-away birds are calling in a very lackluster manner, whee, which is quite often a response to predators, but I think at this time in the morning, it's just their morning dawn chorus. All of the birds are starting to wake up at the moment and they're calling right around us. Oh, girl. Oh, it's important to remember that an elephant, despite looking like a big clumsy thing, is absolutely not. And she is more than capable of navigating any place that a human being could go on two legs. In other words, without having to climb, an elephant can go anywhere that you can walk. It's a wonderful thing about elephants. So this drainage line wall, there you go. A display of acrobatic prowess. She's got one leg at the bottom of that steep incline and then is kneeling on the knuckle of her other leg to reach forward and get that sickle bush. Be interesting to see what she's going to do from here. Oh, we're now doing an almost head. It's quite an interesting approach. Fair enough. Fair enough. Just have a look at how nimble an elephant can be. She's now on her back knees with both front feet down in the dip. Wonderful. Dina was wondering whether or not this lovely young lady is a Kruger Ellie, could be a Kruger Ellie, which might be why she's not as comfortable with us in the vehicle. Dina, absolutely that is a possibility. We're seeing more and more elephants coming in from the western side of Kruger through Torchwood and Cheetah Plains and Inkoro and across to us. And a lot of them from that section of the Kruger National Park don't encounter cars all that often. It's quite entirely possible. I also think that the smell of lions might have put her slightly on edge. I don't think it's been too long since they've come through here. It might be that why she's stressed, but I think the biggest reason is that she just wants us to know that she feels cut off from the rest of the herd. So she's the only elephant on this side of the drainage line, which is why I've been very careful about not putting us between her and the rest of the herd. She's a young female, and I don't want to frighten her or scare her in any way. And we're just going to sit here quietly because she's very kindly moving into our space. But we're going to respect that choice from her and let her move past in comfort. It's okay, big girl. All right, big girl. It's all right. All right. It's okay. You're okay. And I'm a girl. And I'm a girl. It's okay. It's all right. Here you go. Here you go. It's okay, big girl. It's all right. Now, if that had been a young male, that would have been a naughty display, trying to intimidate us. From a young female, that's not why she's doing it. She's doing it because she wants to get to the rest of the herd. She has to go past us in order to do so because the herd moved along behind us after we stopped here. So she was comfortable enough to approach us, but at the same time she wanted us to know, hey, I'm keeping an eye on you, don't do anything. But for her, she's quite small, she's young still. So she's still feeling intimidated. And that was why she was very, very cautious, sniffing, making sure that we behaved properly. And then why she ran past at the back like that, but then stopped just to make sure we weren't going to do anything. And a very warm welcome to Diane in Ontario, who is joining us and is wondering how close we are to the elephants. At her closest, Diane, if I'd stretched my fingers out of the vehicle, I might have been able to touch her trunk. Obviously, I'm never going to do that. The elephants, when they approach us, will come right up to the vehicle. Personally, I never let them touch it. Sometimes there are curious young ones that want to put their trunk on, or a big bull that feels comfortable enough to put their trunk on the vehicle. I always discourage that. But beyond that, the elephants are comfortable enough, if they have approached you, to go within 3 feet, 2 feet, sometimes even close enough to the bottom or to the bonnet or the hood of the vehicle. Right, our ellies moved off, which means we can too, to go and search for those lions. But Brent's been doing some searching of his own, so let's see what he has found.
So I've been trying to work out what happened here last night, and let's put it this way, a lot happened last night. So we found a drag mark away from the last site, but before I did that, I noticed the lion tracks. So the lions were here last night, and there's a track here, just down here on the ground, and I followed the drag mark. The lion tracks were also following the drag mark, and it looks like they might have got a lot of the carcass. On a positive note, I've had a big walk around, and I can't find any dead cubs. So hopefully they managed to escape. There are also male leopard and hyena tracks here. So it seems like there was a lot going on. So I'm going to move a little bit to show you what's left of that impala. Now, from the tracks underneath that tree that Ben was showing you there, I've got to be careful. There's lots of artfark holes around here. I don't want to fall into one of them. Okay, so, and it's a very peculiar tree to choose, this marula here. But you can actually even see where the barks come off from the claws, as the leopard would have climbed up there. And you can see, if we come a little bit further up the tree, you can see that's where most of the carcass was. And you can see there was some feeding happening there. But the only thing left is that leg that I can find. And I've done a proper walk around the area. And very difficult to see which way Karula and the cubs went, because if they were leaving here, they would have been leaving here at high speed. But what looks like happened is the lions managed to jump up and grab some of the carcass. So you can see there's a lot of tracks underneath here. It's quite difficult in the leaf litter, but there's bits of bone. And it looks like, well, either the hyenas or the lions, maybe the carcass was still too high for the lions. But that leg's definitely fallen into that spot there. The leopard didn't put that leg in the tree there. That's fallen from the higher branch. And it would be quite difficult for the leopard to get at that piece of meat. It's within hyena jumping range, though. Maybe the hyenas were here, and then the lions chased them, and then... Oh, I don't know. It's too confusing. The tracks are literally all over the place. So we're going to stay in this area and keep checking. So I'm going to get back onto the road, see if we can find any tracks going in any direction, and let's just hope that those little cubs are safe. While we move out of here, I just want to check. There's some nice little thickets and stuff. You never know what's going on. And I mean, the male leopard tracks as well could be more than likely Tingana. But definite pandemonium happened here last night. But no sign of any cat, lion, leopard, or even a hyena at the moment. Now, these type of situations happen on a daily basis out here in the bush, so it's no reason to be overly concerned. We just don't happen to be with these animals for 24 hours. So, I mean, these cubs have probably encountered lions more times than we have in the last week. Okay, so we're going to go check around this block. So while we check the tracks in this area, we've got a question from Brian Deere about the word game reserve. He says, is that a throwback from the yesteryear, where it means hunting reserve? And is there still hunting on Jumo and Arethusa? There hasn't been hunting on Jumo and Arethusa for many, many years. And now, the term game reserve in certain parts of Africa does mean hunting reserve. In South Africa, it tends to be the opposite, but most of the game reserves started off as hunting reserve. The oldest game reserve in Africa, in fact, is in South Africa, and it is now called Lihluyamfolozi Game Reserve, and that actually extends back to the Zulu kings. It was the junction of the black and white Umfolozi rivers was the private hunting area of the Zulu kings. So that's been protected for a couple of hundred years, but in Tanzania, the word game reserve is often still used as a hunting reserve, but and in national parks. But out here, a game reserve is a protected area for animals. Even if they might have started off as hunting reserves, they are no longer hunting reserves in this particular part of South Africa. In other parts of South Africa, there are game reserves that still do hunt, but nowhere in the Sabi science. cake. So we're going to be focusing quite a bit on game reserves, national parks, and it is a Kruger National Parks birthday week this week. Its actual birthday is tomorrow, and it'll be 90 years old. So we are part of the Greater Kruger National Park. So there's no fence between us and the Kruger National Park. So wonderful to be part of this historic and amazing area. Okay, so no tracks here, but I didn't expect there to be. I'm just sort of double checking. I really expected from where the lion tracks came from that if Kurula and the Cubs did move from there, they would have gone sort of south and south and east or south and west, so somewhere into this block. So while we continue to check very carefully for tracks and try to figure out what happened at that carcass, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
I'm also looking very carefully for tracks, and I have found them, unfortunately, with some bad news here. Looks as though, unless I'm very much mistaken, where have they gone? Are there any on this side? I'm almost inevitable that they've come through here. There we go. And there our lions go, including a male track I saw earlier. We are on the eastern boundary of Juma, and across they go straight into Torchwood. I can see that there's, I just want to hop out, which means, hold on, I have to pop my incredibly brightly coloured hot water bottle that's been keeping me somewhat warm out of my jacket. I just want to hop out quickly and just have a look at these tracks. I want to see for myself if the male is with them. I don't know, of course. There's no way for me to know whether or not it is Junior or whether it is one of the Birmingham boys that's with them now. Most likely is that it is Junior, since he has been with them for the last 2 days. And this track here, I mean, the Nkuhuma ladies have relatively big feet, but not that big. This track here made, we've missed them by probably about 2 hours. Just looking at the tracks gone into the dew and disturbed it to get the dry sand underneath. So this was after the dew settled this morning. And his track here, can you see it sort of, Gendre? Kind of. It's not the best light, but there's a male's tracks. Here's his back pad. So the three lobes. Here are his four toes. And a track this size, which is now very messy, a track this size is unfortunately not a female. Okay, well, I'm just checking that that isn't a lion. It's not a lion, it's a bush. Well, unfortunately, we cannot follow where these tracks are leading us. They're going straight across outside of our traverse area. Now, if you don't quite understand what that means or why we can't follow them, every single lodge in this area has certain places they can drive and certain places that they can't. It's one of the ways in which they keep an area from being overloaded with vehicles, making sure that they're not put under any pressure. Genre, can we have a look right at the back? I think it's impala that I can see moving right at as far as you can see on that road before it curves to the left of the termite mound. Thought I saw movement there. No. Okay. But yes, there are certain areas that we cannot go. I don't know what I saw there. It might just have been a bird moving about. And there are certain places we cannot go, and this is one of them. I haven't quite given up yet though, because the Nkumas quite often go onto Torchwood and then do a loop in either direction, whether they go south or whether they go north. And we'll go and we'll check Wiffles Hook Dam just in case that has happened, which is up to the north of us. We'll just check along the eastern boundary. I doubt it. I think that they're going straight to where that female is on first rock with her cubs. We've just got to hope at this point that either Junior's still got some familial instincts left, or that it is a Birmingham boy with the Nkumas. There are actually... no, there aren't. For newer viewers, an adult male lion's instinct is to kill cubs that are not his own. Now, Junior is related to the female that has had the cubs. I don't know whether she's his mother or his aunt, but she will in some way be related to him. However, he's an adult male now. He has left the pride. I'm hoping it's not an inevitability. It's not inevitable that he will seek out and try to kill those cubs. He might leave them alone. He might recognize that they are related to him in some way. I hope that that will be the case. We just don't know at this point, and we'll have to wait to find out. Hopefully one of the other guides that can go on to Torchwood will hurry along and go and find out for us. Ooh, let's get up to a crest. Chilly, chilly, chilly. Sheila, you were wondering if Junior did come upon the Nkuhuma cubs, and if he did act to kill them, would it be because they have been sired by the Birmingham boys? Yes, that would be why. It would be because he knows he is not the father of them. Now, it might seem like a really brutal system that male lions have going on, but it's a very important way of keeping the genetic stock of the lions out here fresh and as resilient as they can possibly be. So a male, when he comes into a territory, when he establishes himself or themselves in a territory, they know it's not an easy life being a male lion. They've got 2, maybe 3 years on average in which to propagate their genetic line. And what that means is that they need to kill the cubs of the previous males in order to bring the female back into estrus and get her mating with them as quickly as possible. I'm distracted by the kudu and I am enjoying their breakfast in this crisp morning light. And while we watch her, I just want to chat to Mike very quickly. Oh, Mike, those Nkunzo go straight across Cheetah Cut Line on Central Road. I don't know if they're going towards First Rock where that one Mafuzzy is. There's also tracks of one Madodo with them. So, Mike tells us that he is going on his way to check up on what's happening there. So hopefully we will have some answers to satisfy everybody's concern and curiosity as to what is happening there. There's definitely no tracks coming back out in this direction. And so we shall go on to search for other things, including Tingana, because as James Richard reminded us yesterday, it's been a month since we last saw the dominant male leopard of this area, and I feel as though that needs to be remedied. Gorgeous girls. There's plenty of time to stop and have a look at these beautiful animals. exceptionally elegant creatures. And then, chirping away in the background, the fork-tailed drongos, waiting for the insects to be disturbed. Although they're going to start to battle relatively soon, as the insect life dies off as we go into our winter dry season. Oh, and there's another bird for us to add to the list for this morning before... they're so difficult to get on camera, but they're absolutely one of my favorites. And that is the emerald spotted wood dove that we so often get pottering about in the middle of the road. Now, it's unfortunate that the sun isn't a little bit higher so that you could see where it gets its name, the emerald spotted wood dove. Although you can sort of see, there you go, got a bit of a glimmer from those patches on its wings. Those are bright, bright green in the sunlight. Very sweet little birds with their grey heads. And I feel one of the best, most descriptive names, emerald spotted wood dove, pottering about looking for whatever seeds it can find. Now, in local culture, strangely enough, these birds are believed to be exceptionally bad luck. It's thought that you must never listen to the entirety of their call, which apparently it's them saying, I'm sad, 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 sad. I've listened to their call plenty of times, though, and I don't think I can attribute it to any bad luck that I have had. Lots and lots of superstitions around the different birds of this area. The dove family, unlike in other parts of the world, is actually a symbol of conflict rather than a symbol of peace. In local African culture, they are the birds of war, almost. And then, of course, the lilac-breasted roller being the symbol of peace in this particular part of the world. Despite the fact that actually lilac-breasted rollers can be very aggressive when they want to be, and they're not afraid to mob birds of prey twice their size. Yes, this is one of the shyest and most harmless, inoffensive of bird species and is yet considered to be bad luck. Not as much, however, as a bird called a hammerkop. A hammerkop, or a hammerhead, in literally translated into English, the bird that we see around water and is absolutely considered to be bad luck. And if one flies over your house here, it means that it's going to be struck by lightning and that you have to go and find certain trees, including the magic gwari tree, and put it over your door frame in order to prevent that from occurring. You can make of that what you will. Poor hammerkop also claiming a somewhat undeserved reputation. Good morning to you, Edmund. We had a long discussion yesterday about the various raptors of the park and which ones are the most efficient at hunting, and I said that I couldn't begin to guess or to even answer which would be the most successful hunters. But you wanted to know what are the largest and what are the smallest raptors in the Kruger National Park. The largest, hands down, as a bird of prey is the martial eagle. The martial eagle is absolutely enormous, well over 6 feet in terms of wingspan. Very big, very heavy, bulky eagle. There are also exceptionally large vulture species. Things like the lappet-faced vulture also have very, very large wingspans, as do... Sorry, I'm just listening to updates on the Game Drive channel. As do the Cape vultures of the area, Cape vultures and lappet-faced vultures not really considered to be birds of prey specifically. They very, very seldom hunt. And then the smallest, there's a couple of them. Pygmy falcon is very, very tiny. The black-shouldered kite is also exceptionally tiny. I have forgotten my bird book at home once again. I was busy double checking something yesterday. I'm sure that Brent, if asked or if he has a moment, will be able to show you a picture. In the meantime, let's find out how his search is going.
So, we've been busy deciphering a puzzle here, and I've literally had to get right down on the ground to do it. But it's looking like very good news. So over here, there is Karula's track. And over here, it looks to be the little male's track, about half the size of Mom. And then over here, even smaller, the little female track. There's two of them there. So Karula, and looks like both babies have come down here, so they've managed to survive whatever pandemonium happened at that carcass last night. These tracks look really nice and fresh, so maybe we'll have some leopard luck yet this morning. But very good to know. Of course, with tracks like this, it's quite difficult, but I'm 95% confident that we've got all three here, and so all three must have survived whatever happened at that carcass last night. So we're going to stick on the tracks. They are heading south, and I'm hoping she got towards the area around Treehouse Dam and decided to stop there. Now, it was very confusing because there's tracks of both the cubs and her going in both directions. I think the other tracks of her fetching the cubs and taking them to the carcass, where there is these ones definitely fresh. It took me about 5 or 6 minutes looking for a very specific track, and it's the track on top of the other track, so just to get the right direction, because both these sets of tracks look really nice and fresh. So they're all 12 hours or younger old. There are the other tracks coming up this way, but on the one side. So there's tracks coming this way on the one side, and we're following the tracks going that way on the other. So sometimes it's a bit of a puzzle out here, and you've got to work it out. And I just need to and female leopards with oh dear no still going now all of a sudden I saw tracks going the other way, and I was like, oh, which one's a witch? Gonzo of one Satiingwe and two Mampimpan heading south on from the Balanites tree onto Zoe's road, following up. Okay, so if I'm not looking back at you guys, I do apologize, but I am trying to keep my eye on the road. We don't want to lose these tracks. But isn't this beautiful? Early winter's morning. Fresh leopard tracks, not even just leopard tracks, leopard and cub tracks. Sun peeping up over the eastern horizon, and hopefully in not too long we'll have some luck with the queen and cubs. So if you've just joined and might have missed yesterday's sunset safari, Karula was on an impala carcass, and during the night lions and hyenas came there, and she's obviously abandoned. There is a little bit of meat left in the tree, but she's abandoned that area, obviously deciding it's a bit unsafe for her offspring with all those other predators around. Oh dear. No, they're still going this way here. Now, I'm hoping she just didn't decide, I'm going back south. I'm out of here. There's too many other predators around, so I'm hoping she hasn't gone all the way back across our southern boundary, which is about a kilometer from here. Fingers crossed. So apologies, there seems to be gremlins in both Jamie and my streams today. So we're just going to go to the dam cam for about 5 or 6 minutes while our tech team tries to sort it out. And I'm going to keep on these leopard tracks. So hopefully when we get back, we'll have a leopard for you.
That still leaves the fifth missing. Not boy. She might still be, or she might just not have managed to find the rest of the pride just yet. Peter, you've asked.
So it seems like Jamie's still got a few gremlins. Hopefully we get them ironed out as soon as possible. And you're going to be with Vim and I while we try and track Queen Karula. So far, no tracks coming out. There's a strong possibility she could still be in this very big block here. There is a lovely little creek, a dry creek system in the center, which is a place to keep cubs. Lots of mountains, big tree, great place to keep them safe. We are going to check here. I think if they are going to come out, they're going to come out somewhere in this area around the junction with Shabam Road. So if they haven't, I think there's a very strong possibility she's still that side. And they haven't. So what we're going to do is we're going to keep circling the block. Just make sure maybe she's gone a little bit further to the east. You never know. And we know how the queen likes to change direction. I was hoping with cubs with her, she was going to keep a more direct line, but the queen is the queen. So, unfortunately, it seems like our gremlins have not been solved. We're going to have to go across to Tech Loop while our geniuses in camp try to fix it.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gharri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being alive and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gharri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush. But our tech crew is on it and not asleep, like the lions behind me. Hopefully, we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush. But our tech crew is on it and not asleep, like the lions behind me. Hopefully, we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being alive and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gari repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being alive and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly. Thank you.
sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep, like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Good morning and welcome back to our sunrise safari. We do apologize, we seem to be beset by gremlins on this somewhat chilly morning out here in the African bush. For those of you who've been with us since the start of the sunrise safari, thank you for sticking with us. We do appreciate it. As you know, there are technical issues involved in bringing you a live safari straight from the heart of South Africa. But for those of you who are joining us now for the first time, welcome to our live safari here on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. I'm currently driving along Drakensberg Road. We spent the morning, or the first part of the sunrise safari, tracking to see if we couldn't find any lions, but they have crossed onto the property to the east of our boundaries. My name is Janie, and this morning I have Jandre on camera with me. Brent is out on foot. He's tracking the Queen of Juma, the leopard Karula, and her two cubs. I'm sure that when he gets back to the vehicle, you'll all be keeping fingers crossed that he has exciting news to tell you. I have an update for you. They have found the three females on Torchwood property, so the three female lions that were seen on the Juma Dam camera this morning. However, from what I understand, they cannot see a male with them. We were tracking three females and one male, but the male has since split away from that group on Torchwood and moved off somewhere else. We don't know where. We'll have to wait to be updated as to whether or not they find him. And of course, most of us thinking that it is Junior. I have no idea. I can't confirm. I can't deny. It could also be one of the Birmingham boys, the dominant males of this area. We will just have to wait and see if we can find out. They covered that ground incredibly quickly this morning. From 4 o'clock in the morning, being at the Vuyatela Dam, to where they are on Torchwood in a straight line, it's about, I would say, probably close to 5 kilometers that they have walked in the space of 2 hours. The Nkumas can do that when they want to. They stretch out and they cover serious ground, led by the amber-eyed female, who always seems to take the lead when moving the pride. One of the oldest and most experienced females of that group of five lionesses. No news yet on the female who is hiding cubs in that area, the Nkuhuma lioness. Obviously all keeping fingers crossed that Junior doesn't encounter her and her new babies. Although he is young, and I think that she would put up a most spirited defense if he were to try anything. Hopefully she would be able to see him off. Unfortunately, he is big enough now that he is a serious threat to both her and her cubs. They've gone exactly where we didn't want them to go. and going down a slightly morbid path, we have a question from Rachel, who was wondering if it is true, if the cubs were killed, is it true that the female might eat her cubs? Yes, it is. It's relatively unusual for lionesses to eat their own cubs, but it does occur. It's basically pragmatism. Her resources are depleted having gone through the birth and the lactation period involved. And as a result, there is a chance that she might eat the cubs. It's actually more common in leopards. It does happen with leopards if they lose a cub that they will eat it. Less common, cannibalism with lions is less common but does occur. Usually, the cannibalism that occurs within a lion society occurs with males taking over a pride or taking over an area. They automatically kill the cubs and occasionally will eat them, as well as they'll also nibble on any males or females that they have killed during that process. Again, it's not really eating for food in that situation. Doesn't always happen. We had the incident with the Birmingham boy and the Styx cub last year, where he didn't, as far as we could tell, he never ate the cub that he'd killed and brought with him. That was Scrapper, or Tokolosh, depending on who you ask about his name. That was one of the youngest Birmingham boys who has since died of what we think were hunting-related injuries, apparently. But he never ate that cub, as far as we know. He carried it around for a little bit, but he didn't eat it. It's a harsh world, and it's very difficult for us to not attach human emotions to what is happening with the animals. But of course, there's no judgment placed upon them. It is their natural instinct to act in that way. But we don't know that he's going to kill those cubs. We don't even know if it is Junior that's crossed through into Torchwood. I think it might be. I haven't seen any of the images from the Juma Dam camera, so I can't confirm or deny. We've just got to hope at this point that he behaves himself. Or, it's a difficult one, or that the Birmingham boys are around to protect the cubs, but then obviously that puts Junior, the Nkulma male, at risk. I have to be honest, in a way, I wish he had stayed elsewhere. Sorry, excuse me. Lots of dust about this morning. Aaron, you were wondering if I think that Junior might have decided to return because the two lionesses are not with the pride, so there's only three at the moment. Maybe. I don't know. I think he sort of set out on his own. I think that he failed to find company. Now, a young male lion on his own is very much at risk. And the biggest desire in a young male lion's head, or instinctively, is to find another young male lion, or another two or three young male lions, and join up and sort of combine and form a coalition with them. They don't have to be related. They can be complete strangers to him. But I think Junior failed to do that. And I think he returned, if I had to guess, I would say he returned to a place of comfort. He's been doing okay all on his own, from what we've seen, from the pictures that we've seen. And he did come back here a couple of months ago, very briefly. He popped onto Simbambili, a property to the northwest of our boundary. And then he disappeared again for a while. I don't know what his motives are. I think just a comfort thing, maybe. Return to where he knows and the family that he knows. But it's really not a good thing to have him around here. And it's the most dangerous decision, both for himself and for the pride, that he could have taken. We're going to go and help Brent a little bit, because he's on the way towards a message that Taxon has just sent me. He said that there's vultures everywhere around Arethusa, as well as hyenas running backwards and forwards. So we're going to head there, but we're also going to help Brent by checking our southern boundary and making sure that Karula and her cubs haven't crossed to the south towards Little Gowry, where they've been spending most of their time. And it just helps us to divide and conquer, essentially, when tracking an animal like this. And speaking of tracking leopards, Brent is back on the vehicle, so let us find out how his time on foot went.
So, no luck just yet. Unfortunately, as I walked off into the area where I thought Karula and the cubs had gone, I encountered not one, not two, not three, but many, many elephants. So we had to reverse. So I'm just hoping maybe she's one step ahead of us, and I'm going to find her tracks on Philemon's where we passed a bit earlier. So we're going to go look now. I just thought I'd check the southern boundary quickly, and I've now come off the boundary and I'm Shabam Road heading back. Last tracks were heading generally in this direction, but as I said, big herd of elephants in the middle of the block forced me to reverse. Let me rephrase. It was a tactical retreat. We haven't given up yet. But we are keeping a very close eye for any tracks at the and just keeping his sharp eyes out and about, saying he can probably spot her on the move. But if we can somewhere. Virginia is in Kentucky, which is one of the military seat there. They recognize these trees by sight or smell. I would say by sight, and I don't think they know it's a marula tree, Virginia. And it just happens that marula trees are the most prominent large tree in our area. In different parts of the world, they use any tree that's easy enough to lift a carcass. So even here, I've seen them use bush willows, we've seen them use leadwood, we've seen them use false marulas, we've seen them use jackalberries and scotias. So it just depends on what shape the tree is closest to them, which makes it easy for them to hoist the kill up into the tree. Marulas tend to have the best shape in this area. So while we keep checking very, very carefully in this area, Jamie has got the tallest creature living today.
The tallest creature. We go from Brent's search for a spotted animal to our success in finding a spotted animal. Perhaps quite the one we were expecting, but lovely nevertheless. A young female giraffe and then a mature bull standing over her at the back, both of them snacking at the bush willows and various trees in this river system. You can really see the contrast here. If we have a look at the male with his big thick ossicones, his dark color, much, much taller, even though he is standing above the young female. And then we have a look at her. Look at that difference in color, first of all. They could almost be different subspecies of giraffe, which of course they're not. They are the same subspecies. It's just quite a clear show of sexual dimorphism between a male and female giraffe. And then much thinner ossicones. Those strange horns on the top of their head. Just hold on 1 second, I'm taking my earpiece out. Heard a baboon alarm calling, but it's gone quiet now. Look at that. That tree that she's just stuck her face straight into is exceptionally thorny. Thick, hooked thorns that pierce the skin. Not of a giraffe. And those long, long eyelashes keeping her eyes protected, making sure that she, there you go, you can see them in action, making sure she closes her eyes and dodges any thorns that might risk her eyesight. And then the nostrils automatically and instinctively closing as she nibbles on the various leaves. With her head right down low to get into what looks like either a knob thorn or a black monkey thorn that the elephants have very kindly pushed over for them just to make life a bit more convenient. And as we watch them nibble away, you're looking at the largest ruminant out here. And Clown Sharon was wondering about where it is that an animal gets their protein from, since it is such a crucial part of any, of the makeup of any organic organism. How is it that herbivores manage to get it since they don't eat meat? Really interesting answer to that. So Clown Sharon, as you know, a lot of the digestive processes that happen within a ruminant or a hindgut fermenter stomach, so the two different digestive systems that the herbivores have, within those stomachs there are hundreds of thousands of bacteria that help to break down the plant material. Now those bacteria don't have infinite lifespans and in fact play a huge role in providing the animal with a protein source. Isn't that interesting? So they're not just helping the animal in terms of digesting and breaking down plant material, but they actually are playing a role in supplementing their protein content as well. And they'll also get, they will get some of it from the plants, just like all organisms. Plants have proteins within them, part of the makeup of the DNA and RNA of any cell. I'm taking up my earpiece again. What are these baboons shouting at? I think it's just discipline. They're far away. They're off to the south of us in Chitwa. In fact, I think it's so faint that I don't think that you'll be able to hear it on your side. Always good to listen out for baboon calls because they have such sharp eyesight. They're the first to spot a threat. Ah, I can, they're screaming, it's discipline, it's not alarm calling. I spoke about the fact that they look like they could be subspecies, these two giraffes, since they are so different. They're not, they are two of the same subspecies. Sorry, I probably didn't express that terribly clearly. Could have made that clearer. These are two of the same subspecies. Edmund, the number of giraffe subspecies is a contested idea. The generally accepted amount is actually 7, but some people have even argued for 9. Now, out here, we only get one type of giraffe subspecies, and that is the savannah or the southern African giraffe. So we only have one. We don't get the things like the Maasai giraffe or the Rothschild giraffe, or anything like that. I'm trying to, I have a picture somewhere of the different subspecies, but it appears to have vanished off where I thought it was. Just double checking. That the subspecies largely identifiable by their different spot patterns and their different colorations. And they're found spread throughout Africa. Now for us here, in this protected area, our giraffe are very, very safe from harm. That being said, giraffe as a whole, giraffe as a species throughout Africa are actually quite endangered. Just like most of the wild animals out here, they are under threat just purely by habitat loss for a start, and also poaching for bushmeat in different parts of Africa. But we're very fortunate in that our giraffe species are perfectly safe. And there she's giving you a beautiful demonstration of the purple tongue that giraffe have, impregnated with melanin in order to make it nice and tough so that she can do things like roar. That makes it, even though I've watched them do it my entire life, it still makes me cringe slightly when they wrap their tongues around thorn trees. Because I have walked into those thorn trees before, and I know what those thorns are like. Giraffe's mouth just totally impervious to it. And that tongue that we keep catching glimpses of can extend up to close to 50 centimeters, around 20 inches in length. Considerably dexterous. Able to wrap around and pick out the individual leaves that she's after. Might be my imagination, but she looks like she's really enjoying that meal. Our male might have other things on his mind. At the moment, breakfast is important, but I think that he is following this female for a reason. It could well be that she is going to start coming into estrus soon, and he is courting her. Oh, he's having a good ruminating session. If so, he has his work cut out for him. Female giraffe don't make it all that easy, and he'll have to do a good 2 weeks of following. Ah, look at that, we've even got a view of his teeth. When last did you get to look at a giraffe's teeth as it ruminates? The row of incisors in the front for nibbling away at leaves. And then obviously the grinding molars at the back. I'm very strongly of the opinion that the longer you look at a giraffe, the weirder they start to look. Just such peculiar animals. Those flattened nostrils that can close up immediately in when faced with thorns so that they don't go right in there and prick the sensitive skin of the nostrils. Those pretty long eyelashes to protect their eyes. And then for a male, the prominent bones of his skull. Now if we watch, because he seems to be ruminating, we might even get to watch the cud. There, he's going to swallow this mouthful. And we might even get to see, there it goes down. Now we should see the next one come back up. Wait for it. Got to work against gravity in order to do so. Oh, we've missed it somehow. Because he's clearly got another mouthful. Difficult to see in this light, and especially with this dark fur of his. In the plant material initially, then formed into boluses that are then brought up once again and re-chewed, because you can never chew your food too many times, and then swallowed once again. So it's ruminating. They are the largest ruminants that we get out here. One of my favorite questions, because we always get such surprised viewers on the other end of this. So we have a new viewer called Omar Johnson, who would like to know if this is really live or if this is pre-recorded. We are really live. Hello and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. Omar Jordan, it is fantastic to have you on board with us. And if you do have any questions about what it is you're seeing, where we are, for example, what we do, what the characters are doing, and our characters, in other words, the animals that we've got to know and love, or just general questions about the many mysteries of the African bush, you can send those through to #SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And welcome to your newest addiction. We are live every day, twice a day, in coming to you from South Africa. And at the moment, I don't know if you've been watching the show since the beginning, but in just the few hours that we've been out and about this morning, we have tracked lions. Unfortunately, the lions went off our boundary and away from where we could follow them. And Brent is currently tracking a leopard. Sorry, I lost my train of thought there because it was a very peculiar sound that I suspect was just an elephant making a strange rumble. But I think there's lions walking around the property to the south of me, just by the baboons and our upset elephants. And there he goes, our female, and our male will not be far behind. Yep, there he goes. Making sure she doesn't have... straight through the trees. Making sure that she doesn't get too far away. And he's going to spend, if indeed she's coming into estrus, he is going to spend the next few weeks trying to follow her around. And if he's really lucky, and if another big male doesn't come along and chase him away, he might have a chance to mate with her. Giraffe don't have a strict breeding season. Right up until we saw that behavior, that following behavior, his intentions might have been entirely innocent. Giraffe don't have a set herd structure, but they can be gregarious animals. They do like to spend time with each other. They just don't really have a set herd or a set territory. Oh no, Jean-André, we're going back into the dip. And now the sun hasn't even come out. Now the clouds have arrived. Oh. It is going to be a day for hot chocolate in large quantities, or coffee in large quantities, or tea, depending on everybody's personal tastes. Whew. And of course now my hot water bottle's got cold. So while I bemoan my frozen state and Jean-André's frozen state, let's see if Brent is feeling the cold as well.
Sorry guys, it seems like we've just had a bit of a problem with our mic as you cross to us. VM's busy trying to fix it as we speak. So I'm talking up to the top mic at the moment. We're going to try and fix it right now. So you're just going to have to look at my ugly mug for a little bit while VM fiddles around. But we've got some news. There has been a leopard spotted in Arethusa. I'm not exactly sure exactly where yet.
Let me grab the backup.
Oh, we're going to go with our backup mic, so sorry. I have to change things around. Sorry about this.
You also have to switch to batteries.
While we fiddle around with batteries and mics, let's jump back on to Jamie, who's got a monkey.
Oh well, we haven't got very far down the road before we spotted this little vervet monkey. And I'm trying not to focus my attention too much on him, as is Jean-André. Although Jean-André, of course, can't help it, since he has to film. And the reason I'm saying that is we're actually very, very close to him, or her. I can't tell at this point. Which gives us this incredible view, but also means there's a good chance it's going to dash away at any moment. Primates just have the most incredibly expressive eyebrows. I think that's what makes them, one of the things that makes them so easy to identify with. Whoop, whoop. And what makes them look so naughty? What have you found there? Adaptable, very clever little creatures, and entirely omnivorous in terms of their diet. Mostly they are herbivores, and there's a whole load of them. Look. hanging out around the drainage. Up in the big marula trees and the jackalberries. That's a jackalberry, sorry. And looking for fruits. You can see the berries that don't look very ripe at the moment. But nevertheless, monkeys can't afford to be fussy. They'll pick their way through. But there you go, using those clever little primate hands with opposable thumbs. The bits of fruit. Good scratch at the same time. You need to get a friend to come and groom you. Complexities govern the life of a vervet monkey. It is the only monkey species that we have. We also see chacma baboons every now and again. That's what we were hearing calling earlier. There you go, we've got an adult female there. You can tell just by the lack of blue testicles. Now the dominant male, or the dominant males in a vervet monkey troop, will have very clearly advertise, well, they very clearly advertise their dominance and their receptiveness to the females in the form of blue genitals. And primates, of course, have very clear color vision, which is one of the reasons why they color has become such an important part of their reproductive life. Advertising when a female is in estrus or when a male is dominant in an area. Here's our little mischievous chap from earlier. He's crossed the road in front of us. And in this kind of view, you can actually really see just how coarse that fur is of theirs. Perfect insulating layer for a small animal, both good at keeping heat in and heat out in summer. And those smaller ears tell you something about a vervet monkey's dominant senses, unlike most of the animals that we see out here, giraffe included. If we look at the size of a giraffe's ears compared to the rest of it, monkeys have relatively small ears, just as we do. Large eyes and large brains, which tells us that they are a very visually dominant species. They can still hear far better than we can, and they can still smell far better than we can. I'm not sure if you heard that low grumbling sound there. That sounds like an angry tiger might in your imagination, but that was in fact an elephant. It's not a cat. Always amazing to watch the comfort level of a vervet monkey up in a tree, balancing on the thinnest possible branches, leaping from place to place. I have never seen a vervet monkey misstep, unless I have seen little ones fall off trees, misjudge a leap perhaps, or the strength of a branch, but I have never seen an adult vervet monkey do it. Oh, sorry, I'm trying to hold my foot on the brake because the gears won't hold us. So that was not Jandre's. It's not Tummy's rumbling, nor is it the, nor is it Jandre's camera work or any other such things. That is the fact that Rusty won't hold us purely with her gears alone. And I've got my foot on the brake, and apparently my calf muscle decided that it was tired of pressing down. Sorry about that. And generally, a vervet monkey troop will consist of several related females. Somebody's trying to creep really carefully across the road. We see you. We see you. It's okay, little one. Shame, it's a young monkey. Creep, creep, dash. There's actually one more, shame. I think the last of the lot. Here we go. Most of the troop has now made its way to the other side of the road, where the females of this troop, all related to each other. There's a tiny little one that's about to cross. Hello, little mischief. Oop, and freeze. Creep, creep. Dash! It seems to be the way that they like to move. Creep, 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 and then dash up to gain momentum on a slope. Rachel, you were wondering how the vervet monkeys keep from interbreeding. Do the males, the adult males, disperse? And yes, and in fact, occasionally females will disperse as well. Oh my word, I will get back to that question. We seem to be at the crossing point. There's now a head watching me that is very definitely not a vervet monkey. On the left of the drainage line there, peeking out from around the side. We should just sit here, Jandre, in future. Although it's a bit too cold. Yep, there we go. Creep, creep, dash. Across the open road. Sorry, Rachel, I haven't forgotten your question. I will come back to it in a moment. There goes an adult male waterbuck, also making his way into the drainage line. It appears this is the place to be on a Monday morning? I think it's Monday. Yes, it is Monday. It's definitely Monday. It is the crossing point for all of the animals. They do enjoy the drainage lines. There we go. Species number 3. Male impala. Like all male impala, looking a little bit the worse for the wear. But back to our monkey question. Rachel. Okay, this is getting ridiculous. Hold on, I've got the handbrake up and everything. Stay! Got my foot well tucked onto the brake here. Rachel, yes, male monkeys will disperse at between sort of 4 to 5 years old. They will move out and they'll try and find a new troop. It's not an easy thing to do because monkey troops are very much dominated by the females. The females often band together and can be quite aggressive towards the males. Even though the males are slightly bulkier and slightly stronger, they can be quite, dare I say, henpecked. Maybe not a term that I should really use, but they can be quite dominated by the females of the group. So a male that has dispersed and is now trying to join a new troop, he has an adjustment period to go through. And he's got to win over the adult, more experienced females before he is accepted. I said sometimes females disperse. That's more unusual. They do occasionally. All right. Most of our monkeys have now moved almost out of view. There's just the one on the top there. I can tell you something. If Karula had crossed here, we would have known about it, because these monkeys would be telling us all about it. That harsh alarm call. And the reason that they will alarm call for a leopard is that, yes, Emil, absolutely, a leopard will, and they do, hunt a monkey and catch and eat them. The last monkey kill that we had was Karula, I believe, a couple of months ago, in the Philemon's Cutline drainage line, which is exactly where Brent has been tracking her this morning, funnily enough. A little bit of a coincidence there, but yes, they will. They're the only animal that's capable of keeping up with the arboreal agility of monkeys. All right, there you go, perfect demonstration. There is a gentleman who would very much like to come past me on this main road. So while we move out of his way, I'm going to send you back to Brent.
There we go. Now, a big, dark, dark male giraffe. And feeding off an acacia, and you can see those large thorns. Let's try to reposition a little bit. He's very, very dark. Ah, look at that. He's moved on really quickly. Now, there's quite a few of those acacia species in this area. So they have the most incredible chemical defense against animals that are eating them. So this way, he's going to walk up to the open there. There we go. So if there's a couple of acacia species of the same, or acacia trees of the same species in an area, if a giraffe starts feeding on them and stays feeding in that area for 10 or 15 minutes or so, maybe even a bit shorter, what happens is that they send out a pheromone that the other trees pick up on. And oh, he's trying the next acacia. Let's see if that acacia is close enough to have got the chemical message. Unfortunately not. He's actually eating on a sickle bush. Stand by one. And so that one hasn't got the chemical message from the acacias. It's not an acacia. So he's probably been feeding on this group of acacias. He's going to disappear now into the block. But there's a whole group of scented thorns, or shangwas is the Shangan name for them. There we go. Liam's going to show them to you now. We're going to have a quick look. So there's one there, another one there, another one there, another one there. And there's a few more a bit further away. But you get the general idea. There's quite a lot of the same species of acacia in this area. So if that giraffe's been feeding here for a while, they'll release that pheromone into the air, and the other acacias close by of the same species will immediately become bitter. So they pump tannins into their leaves that are very bitter and not very tasty if you're a giraffe or a kudu or an elephant or anything that's feeding on those particular trees. So that giraffe has now had to move away, and that's one of the ways acacias stop animals overfeeding on them. And of course they do have those large, white, massive thorns as well. So I came across, we're on Arethusa at the moment, and I came across at the whim. I heard that there was a leopard near the far western boundary of Arethusa, and it turns out he's got a kill, and unfortunately it's just outside our traverse area. And Viem and I got really excited for a while because it was the beast that is known as Mr. Anderson. So hopefully he does decide to come visit Arethusa. I'll definitely be keeping my ear out in case he does come back. So I think we're going to make our way back into that area where Karula's last tracks were. Hopefully that big elephant herd has moved out of the middle of the block, so we've got a good chance of seeing them as well. And I know Jamie's also heading into the area to give us a hand, so I'm just going to have a quick chat to her. I think I'm going to get her to check further to the south, just in case Karula has kept moving. This morning's actually got colder rather than warmer. And I'd say we're probably sitting very close to the same temperature where we started the safari on, which is not a pleasant temperature. It's about 11 degrees Celsius, which is about 51 Fahrenheit. So quite chilly for us here in the bush. So let me just chat to Jamie for two ticks. Jamie. You were looking for me?
Sorry, I just wanted the update from the Western Channel. I've got
to
thank you.
Copy, no problem. Okay, oh, bumpy. So we're about to leave Arethusa. At least we got to see that nice big male giraffe. And hopefully now we can find those elephants. There's also tracks of a big herd of buffalo that crossed into Juma, also in that same area where we last had Karula's tracks. So hopefully she's got the cubs somewhere safe in a nice big tree. And I think what I might do after the sunrise safari is I might take a stroll in that area, walk that area a bit more extensively. Now that hopefully the elephants have moved off, and maybe we'll have her for the sunset safari. But if you are wondering what we're doing and you've just stumbled upon this strange thing and people driving around the bush and we claim it's live, it is live, and we can guarantee that. So if you don't believe me, send me a question. And you can do that by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email me at the email address questions@wildearth.tv. And I'll answer your question, where we are, what we're doing, what we're looking for. And if you're wondering about any of the characters we've mentioned, like Karula, who's the dominant female leopard in this area, Tingana, the dominant male, the Nkuruma Pride of Lions, the Birmingham Boy Coalition of Lions, pop me a question and I'll answer it to the best of my ability. I love Reborns, a new viewer. Welcome to Safari Live. And they would like to know, what country do we live in? Well, we live in the beautiful country on the southern tip of Africa called South Africa. We are in the northeastern area of South Africa in a province called Mpumalanga. A province is similar to a state for us out here. Mpumalanga means where the sun rises, because we're right in the east of the country. If we go down a little bit, we're in the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, 13 million acres of unfenced wilderness for the animals. And if we go down a bit more, we're in the Greater Kruger National Park, which is about 5 million acres. And then we go even smaller, we're in the Sabi Sands Private Game Reserve. So this is private land that is opposite the national park, but there is no fence between us and the national park. And we go a little bit smaller again. We're currently on Juma Private Game Reserve. We operate on three different reserves. We operate on Arethusa, Juma, and Cheetah Plains. Now, there are no fences between these reserves, so the animals are able to move wherever they would like. And currently, we're in the western sector of Juma. And we're hoping to find a female leopard who's proving to be quite elusive this morning. But of course, while we look for leopards, there are so many other amazing creatures, from the tiniest little bug to that tall giraffe we just saw. And I am hoping to get a nice view of some elephants as well on this sunrise safari. And for those of you who might be new, like I Love Reborns, we do it twice a day. So you're more than welcome to join us on a live African safari twice a day. On Central African time, we at the moment start at 6 a.m., but we will be starting at 6:30 a.m. from the 1st of June and ending 9:30 a.m. And then in the afternoons, we get going at 3 p.m. Central African time and end at 6 p.m. Now, I know our viewers are spread through many different time zones, and I will try and remember what the time changes are for everyone just shortly. So, Eastern time is 12:30. Midnight, 12:30 to 3:30 a.m. So if you're in the Northern Hemisphere, you got to be a night owl. But a lot of the drives are recorded and posted, so you can catch up on the drives at a more civilized hour. And then the sunset safari starts at, I'm trying to remember now, Eastern time, 9 a.m. Eastern through to 12 p.m. Eastern, and I'm waiting for the lovely ladies in final control, Rebecca and Louise, to let me know the Western time for the U.S. So 9:30 p.m. to 12:30 a.m. and then 6:30 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. and that's Western time. Okay, so those elephants that were stopping us from tracking Queen Karula have hopefully moved out into this area now. And there was tracks of a big herd of buffalo also converging in this area. So we're going to stop at one of my favorite spots on Juma and look to the east over the Mwati River Valley. Now, when we say river, it's quite a strong word. It's a dry river bed, but I think in most parts of the world, you'd probably call it a creek. There we go. We're looking over the Mwati River Valley. And I wonder where all those elephants went. Can't even hear an elephant, and that's unusual at this time of the year. But hello to Kat in Tampa. Kat is wondering if there are any wild flowers that only come out in winter. Kat, there's one in particular, and as soon as it starts flowering, I will show it to you. It's a little succulent called a narrow-leaved calantia. So, and this is actually one of my favorite little plants out here. And during the winter, as it gets more dry, a lot of this greenery we're seeing at the moment is going to disappear. And when that greenery disappears and the grass even gets really, really yellow, you've got these little calanchos with this bright red flower to sort of stick out in the winter months. Now, our last tracks for Queen Karula were right on this corner here, heading into this big area down here. And I went for a walk in there to see if we could find her. But unfortunately, all I found was lots and lots of elephants. And they seem to have departed as well. So I'm hoping we can catch up with them. But we're very positive because Karula, I am 100% sure she's still on Juma. That means those two babies are still on Juma and somewhere in this area. So it's not all about the lions and leopards, and we get to see some quite interesting little creatures as well. And this is a very pretty bird named the yellow-billed hornbill, sometimes as a joke referred to as a flying banana. He's quite a shy hornbill. He's popped behind. There he goes. Off he goes again. Now, of the hornbill species we get here, the yellow bill's probably the most common. And they eat fruit as well as insects and lizards and whatever they might be able to catch. Oh, cock, 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 cock. Off he goes. Well, hello, Claire. Now, Claire is in the Big Apple, New York, and she's asking about a very interesting little bird species called a honey guide. Now, a honey guide will lead you to honey, and it is true. Now, imagine the evolutionary development that has gone into that fact that that little bird knows if it comes to a person or a honey badger, and it calls at them, and they follow it, it'll take you right to the honey, and if you raid the honey nest or the bee's nest, it will get some food. Now, there's quite a lot of African folklore that is also attached to honey guides, and a pretty common one throughout Africa. If you follow the honey guide to its nest or to the bee's nest, and you don't leave it any morsels, your greedy guts, and you take it all for yourself, the next time you follow a honey guide, it's going to lead you to a man-eating lion or a black mamba. Black mamba is the most venomous snake in Africa and can be very dangerous to a person. Now, in this area, the most common honey guide is a greater honey guide. Very distinct call. It says Victor, Victor. So that's how you remember the name, the call. I'm just going to try and get you a picture of it, Claire. There are some other honey guides, but I've only ever heard and seen the greater honey guide who does the Victor call. So they're not the most snazzy looking birds, but here we go. That is the greater honey guide and species. Now, when you do raid the nest and you leave the honey for the honey guide, the honey is not what the honey guide's after. It's actually the bee larvae that they feed off. So quite a fascinating little bird. And we actually saw the first one on the live drives about a week or so ago. And I'd stopped to get out of the car to go walk and look. I think it was at a tree and talk about a tree. And the honey guide doesn't call you when you're in the car. It waits for you off the car. It doesn't recognize the car as having human beings in it. But when it saw me walking around, oh, but quickly to Jamie and one of the rarest little creatures we get here.
I had a slender mongoose to show you, but as with all of our slender mongoose sightings, it ran away. Let's see if we can try and find it again. I doubt it. I think that it has very much gone to ground. We hardly ever manage to get a slender mongoose on camera, so it's always really exciting when we have the opportunity to do so. And I did try to call it back out with little contact, dwarf mongoose contact calls. That didn't work. Went somewhere here, which really doesn't help us at all, given the vegetation structure. There's about a million places for a slender mongoose to hide. Oh well, next time. They just are a great deal more shy than their dwarf mongoose cousins. The dwarf mongoose we get to see pretty much, I would say, at least once a day on our two sunrise and sunset safari. However, nope, that's a pile of elephant dung. That's definitely not a slender mongoose. Bright colour. However, the slender mongoose and the banded mongoose continually escape us. The white-tailed mongoose, I would say, I see about once a week. Getting it on camera is also a tricky experience, so we only really get, if I had to say, white-tailed mongoose maybe once every 2 weeks. And water mongoose, to the best of my knowledge, never. I don't know whether any of you, the longer-term viewers have ever seen a water mongoose on the live safaris. I know that there are some here. Particularly, there's one that hangs around Sydney's dam because I've seen his tracks, but I have yet to see one here. But they are around. They will be around. The largest of the mongoose species that we get here. Oh, there we go, Joey from Australia. You've apparently just asked about the water mongoose. I've never seen it. I know that it's there though. We've seen its tracks before. They are most definitely water mongoose tracks. I had that confirmed by a couple of people just to double check myself, because the difference between a water mongoose track and a white-tailed mongoose track can be very small, but hello, buffalo. Actually, can we ignore the buffalo for a second, and can we have a look at the birds that are more to the left of us, at the back there? Oh, don't move. Please don't move. There we go. Well done, Jandre. Thank you. They are such interesting birds. They've got bizarre faces. Oh, look, and there's even one feeding its chick on the left. Making almost electronic-like calls. Oh, there's its begging. Look at that. Such clear begging movements. Oh, not today. Shut down and ignored. Oh, no, it's managed to get some food. Sorry, I have been so distracted by what we're looking at, I completely forgot to tell you what they are. They are white crested helmet shrikes, and they're one of my favorite birds. I don't know why. I think it's the vibrancy of their colors. I'm gonna try and go backwards because not often we get to get them on camera with this incredible zoom, mostly because they never sit still, which they are clearly not doing now. Jandro doing a did a fantastic job there. Oh, come on. And I've never ever seen a juvenile one, or never managed to get a juvenile white crested helmet shrike on camera before. I'm very happy that we managed that. And they are cooperative breeders. Oh, it's got something there that it's bashing against the branch. Don't know what it is. Looks like some kind of worm. That seems slight overkill for what it had. Sorry, explosion of information there. I just got a little bit overwhelmed by the excitement. Do you want to go backwards a little bit? There we go, you got it. Well done, Jandre. Excellent. Bearing in mind just how far away these birds are from us, Jandre doing a fantastic job to keep up with them, especially given their erratic path. Okay, let's, now that I've calmed down slightly, all kinds of things get us very interested out here in the bush. Now that I've calmed down slightly, it is a white crested helmet shrike that we were looking at. And they are what's known as, like the oxpeckers and the hornbills, the yellow hornbills, yellow-billed hornbills and the red-billed hornbills, they are cooperative breeders. So the individual that we saw feeding the juvenile there might not have been mom or dad and could actually have been older brother or older sister. They're always fascinating birds to see. We get the white-crested helmet shrike and a bird called the Retz's helmet shrike. And they've got a red eye instead of that yellow band that you see on the white-crested helmet shrike. But more towards the riverine areas, the big trees, the jackalberries and so on. Whereas the white-crested helmet shrikes, they like this mixed bush willow woodland. Our buffalo has completely disappeared. But that's okay, we can see buffalo lots. We will see lots of buffalo. Oh, there he is. Two buffalo. Oh, Brent was walking in this area earlier, and I'm sure that he was paying very close attention, because this is the sort of the kingdom of the Duggar boys. What I mean by that is this part of Juma seems to have the highest concentration of buffalo bulls. And you can see just how easily they disappear, even though they are such large animals. Not always that easy to spot. There's nothing like a surprise buffalo when you're trying to track a leopard to get your heart rate pumping. They're not known for their tolerance, let's put it that way, or their patience. Okay, let us continue on, see what else we can find you. You never know, we've got a few moments left on our sunrise safari. The Queen of Juma could yet be found. View of the buffalo has pretty much disappeared, but Edmund, you were wondering, what is the life expectancy of a buffalo? For a male, really, not probably averages at around 10. An old buffalo could probably live to about 15 in the wild. They're not going to manage to keep going much longer than that. 9 or 10 is already, they're getting a bit old, and 15 is probably the maximum for a buffalo. The females of any species out here almost always live longer than the males. First of all, because the biology of the females makes them slightly more resilient to diseases and injuries, but also just because of the lifestyle that they lead. They stay within the protection of the herd for their entire life. They don't move off on their own like the buffalo bulls do, which does tend to make them more vulnerable to big lion prides with big males that have the strength to hunt and take down a Duggar boy, big buffalo male. The females might live a little bit longer. It's just a matter of luck. They also don't have the physical impacts that a buffalo bull has. Buffalo bulls spar with each other, and they also occasionally have relatively serious fights that result in broken horns, occasionally broken ankles, particularly when they're hanging out around mud wallows and they spar there. They have run a very big risk of twisting an ankle or hurting a hock joint or something like that, which immediately puts them at more at risk of predation. Come on, Karula. It's nice and cool. Time for you to be moving. I'm very glad to hear that Brent had tracks for the cubs as well this morning on the beginning of the sunrise safari. It means that whatever happened with her kill last night, she managed to keep them safe. Or at this point, they can keep themselves safe. They are more than capable of climbing up into trees away from any danger. Apparently, Brent is making his way back towards where she stashed a little bit of the kill. There's a good chance that's been in her mind the whole time. She moved the cubs when it was safe to do so away from the site of the kill, keep them safe and sound away from lions and hyenas. And then she knew that she had a piece stashed away, and probably there's a good chance that she's decided to go back in that direction. And at this point, towards the end of the sunrise safari, although I'm quite disappointed the sunrise never really happened. I mean, the sun obviously came up, but it was thoroughly hidden behind a layer of clouds, which means that we haven't even been able to have an opportunity to sit and bask in the sun for a little bit. But what we're doing is both Brent and myself are zigzagging this area to help us follow up on her and to increase the chances that we catch her on the move. Now, many of you will be aware that we are moving back, we're moving our sunrise safari by half an hour on the 1st of June. And that means it will be midnight to 3:30 a.m. Eastern Time and 9:30 to half past midnight on Western Time. The time zones confuse me terribly, but I have given you the right times. All it means, half an hour later on the Sunrise Safari. And that you will be able to find all of that information on the blog site itself. Stop 1 second. Sorry, I've been distracted. Oh, never mind. Isn't that one of the most bizarre sounds you have ever heard? Who would have thought an antelope could make a sound like that? He got my hopes up for a second. I thought he was alarm calling, but nope. He's a male impala advertising his attractiveness to all the ladies. I'm not quite sure where the appeal lies there, but it's a really fascinating sound. I'm going to roll forward and make Andre's life a little bit easier. We can see if he continues to call. Are you done yet, boy? Last night, a rutting impala ram trying to mate with a female. That last one was a bit strangled. I'm sorry, I'm giggling at that. I can't take them seriously when they do this. I know it's all part of their instinctive response to mating time, but there's just something quite bizarre about the sound that a rutting male impala makes. I was going to tell you about the impala ram that was trying to chase a female to mate with her last night and chased her full speed straight in front of my car. They were fine, both of them were fine, but it did mean that I had slight whiplash from slamming on the brakes so hard. Every now and again, animals just do something so unpredictable. I wasn't even going fast at all, and he just caused her to take leave of her senses completely. She wasn't looking around her at all, and shot in front of me. Definitely not an ideal situation, and the impala rams are so distracted that they are making for easy pickings at the moment, which is why Karula managed to, one of the reasons why Karula managed to catch one. Brent has been en route back to that impala kill, however, he has been distracted along the way. Let's see what animal he's found.
So we've come across some warthogs, and we can see the female is the big one in the foreground, just off to the right. And there's a big male at the back. There he is, coming in a bit closer. And then there's two of last season's babies. Now, warthog have a very defined breeding season, and it is now. So the warthog males have two different strategies, and he's not as relaxed as the others. The female and babies, we are quite used to us, but that male is not. And the fact that it's just moved forward slightly. So, as I said, the males have two very distinct strategies to get mating rights over females. So this guy looks like he's got he's going to defend this little female. So she's probably going to come into estrus very soon, and he's going to be able to mate with her. Oh, he's making the ladies and the babies a bit jumpy. And so warthog males will either defend a group of females, and females live in groups called sounders. So there's often related females, mother and daughters, that will live together. They sometimes forage apart, but they're disappearing. And so a male might defend a group of females as his little mating rights, and they'll fight quite viciously over that. And other males will defend a resource, a really good grazing area or a water hole, or something like that. We came to see if our friend who was curled up in a ball early this morning, still curled up in a ball, there's two of them. And I nearly thought the one was a log. You see them there? One's popped its head up to look at us, and the other is lying just behind it. There we go. They are the two side-striped jackals that were curled up so tightly, and it still stayed cold. And they're still looking like they're not going to get moving anytime soon. And it looks like this little pair, over the last while, has sort of set up a territory around Impala Road and Sandy Patch. But they are very much snoozing in this cold weather. Now, of the jackal species that occur in Africa, the side-striped is the most omnivorous of them and occupies a far greater range of habitat. And if you look at jackal distributions, it's really fascinating when you look at the different jackal distributions of the jackals we get here. While they snooze, we'll have a quick look. There we go. How's that, Navim? Do you want me to move? There we go. So here we are. This is the side stripe. You can see that they're not that common in South Africa. They only occur sort of from Zululand and up the eastern coast into Mozambique and all the way through this big middle belt here, which is Miombo woodland. Now, Miombo woodland doesn't have as high a density of predators. Of course, there are areas within that woodland that are very similar to this and on the rivers and that. And then for me, the most interesting is that they also cross the whole Sahel zone. So you've got rainforest. They also go into the rainforest, which is quite interesting, just on the edges. That's the sort of main Congo basin. But then around the edge, this is what they call the Sahel, which is the West African savanna zone. It's an impala making a noise. But if we look at the black-back jackal's distribution, which is really fascinating for me. Now look at that. So it occurs over the whole of South Africa and Botswana, most of Namibia, outside of the real true Namib Desert, and then carries on in that arid zone to the edge of the wet zone. So this black-back jackal likes a lot more arid areas than wet. Then there's nothing in that Miombo forest zone. Now, at times, obviously, these two populations were connected, but as climate has changed over millennia, the distribution has changed. So they go up to the Zambezi Valley and up into the arid parts of Angola, and then from down along the Rufiji River in Tanzania, they go north through Kenya, most of Ethiopia and Somalia, which is also quite arid in comparison to the Sahel sections. Now, Joey's just asked, do we get golden jackal in South Africa? We don't. There's a golden jackal. So it looks quite similar to a side stripe without the impala snorting away, without the stripe. Now, golden jackal do occur in Africa, but they are the only jackal species that we get that is got a more sort of global thing about them. So they do come right into northern Tanzania. You can see them also in a lot of Kenya. So they share quite a lot of the home range with the black-back jackal in the Horn of Africa. But then they go into the arid areas above that Sahel savanna zone where the side stripes live, and then all the way through the Middle East and into India and into Asia and even into parts of Europe. And that is the golden jackal. So we don't unfortunately get them, but we do see them if you ever go up to East Africa, more in Kenya than in Tanzania. But let's leave these two little schnookums because they look like they're not moving an inch. And I think apart from the impala snorting, I thought I heard an elephant breaking a branch just around the corner. So let's go have a look. Now, it's quite interesting. There's quite a few species that have a very similar distribution to the black-back jackal. And again, it's to do with the type of fauna that they can encounter. So giraffe has a very similar distribution with a big gap in the middle through the Miombo zone. And dik-dik also very strangely have a very similar distribution to the jackal, all closely related. They're not in South Africa itself, but they're northern Namibia and then again in Tanzania. So what I think I thought while I was yapping away was an elephant breaking a branch. It's actually two impala rams fighting. So I can't see a female group around. So this is probably not going to be too fierce, sort of sparring, getting ready for when they do compete with the male that's dominant over the females. Now, watching impala like this often reminds me of sort of fencing duels, all the feints and footwork that goes into the fight. It's all about getting your timing right, when to clash. Well, it looks like they've decided to stop fighting, but we've just seen those little side-striped jackals, so I'm going to throw caution to the wind and see if we can find you a black-backed jackal as well. There was one hanging around on Sandy Patch, and we're right here, so let's go have a look. And as we move deeper into the dry season, I'm getting really excited about all the little things we're going to see. Because we're in a drought year, there's almost no grass cover around, and soon there's going to be very little leaf cover from the trees. And I think we're going to see a lot of interesting mammals that we haven't seen so much since I've been here. And I'm hoping that maybe we'll get an aardvark on camera this dry season. Fingers crossed. So, talking about interesting sightings and things we don't see often, I know Sam saw a reed buck on Cheetah Plains. James Richard is wondering, was that influenced by the drought, or are we more likely to see reed buck in that area? So we are more likely to see reed buck in that area, James. Not ideal, but definitely much better than Juma or Arethusa. And if you head a bit further north from there into Torchwood and Biffle's Hook, you do get quite a few reed buck on those big sodic grasslands that come in from the Manuleti. So they do extend that down as far as Cheetah Plains, but they seem to be more common a little bit further to the north. But yes, not unusual to see, but if we are going to see them, it is most likely going to be on Cheetah Plains. So we're about to pop into the next open area on Sandy Patch. So fingers crossed that there's an incredible beastie. But we'll take whatever we can. So we're going to have a quick look. If there's nothing here, then we're going to go back across to Jamie. So Viam and I are going to start saying our goodbyes. It's been great having you on the Sunrise Safari. And a really interesting morning, even though we didn't see too much. And we do apologize for the tech issues, but really good news, the fact that lions and hyenas came to Karula's carcass last night. But from the tracks, she has managed to get both of those cubs safely out of that potentially very dangerous situation. And I'm definitely going to be looking for her again on Sunset Safari, or maybe I'll let Jamie have a look and I'll head off to Cheetah Plains. We'll have to have that discussion over a nice cup of coffee and breakfast. But so far, I don't see any jackal or other creatures out on.
And you are back on the back of Rusty once again. And I'd just like to apologize on behalf of the entire Wild Earth team for the technology problems that we've been experiencing this morning. It appears that the cold is perfect for gremlin breeding. In other words, the little things that get into all of our technology and our mechanics and cause things to go wrong. Our tech team is furiously working to get everything running and back up to how it should be. But thank you to all of you for your... Oh, my word, I thought we were about to have a gremlin there with a gear change, but we're okay. Thank you to all of you for sticking by us. We really do appreciate it. And of course, there's just, you know, the inevitability of bringing you a live safari from the bush. So I don't know whether or not Brent ever managed to say goodbye to you all, but I think that we'll be saying goodbye on his behalf as well. One last chance, come on. 3 minutes is enough time to find Karula, isn't it? Maybe, maybe not. This is one of her favorite patches. If I were her, I'd be cuddled up somewhere sheltering from the wind. Always the chance of seeing her again this afternoon on the Sunset Safari. And don't forget, guys, that tomorrow it is the 90th birthday of the Kruger National Park, to which we owe a great deal in terms of conservation, and basically to which we are now a part of that incredible conservation area. 90 years of history. What that park has seen coming and going, obviously not just in the 90 years that it was a game reserve, but to have stayed protected and pristine for that extended period of time is a very, very special thing, and one for which we as South Africans and the international world in general, we are exceptionally grateful for. We'll forever be incredibly attached to the magic that is the Kruger National Park. We've come full circle this morning, heading back towards camp and a nice warm cooked breakfast and possibly a nice warm cup of coffee as well. Something for us to look forward to. And to finish off our sunrise safari by saying thank you very much to Jean-André for all of his fantastic camera work as always, as well as to Rebecca and Lou in final control. Most importantly, a big thank you to all of you across the globe for sending through your questions and your comments and for joining us each and every day, twice a day, on our live safaris. And I hope that we've picked up a few new viewers as well. Maybe the start of a hopefully lifelong addiction. There are far worse addictions out there to have, and we still have so many amazing things to show you. And there will be more amazing things on this afternoon's sunset safari, so stay tuned. Perhaps the lions will decide to come back, or perhaps a Karula will decide to wander out into the open and back to a kill. Stay tuned to find out and have a wonderful day or evening. Bye-bye.